Thank you. I love it.
Careful what you ask
for. You can come close. You want to come up here? I got chairs.
No.
Come on.
No, I was like, we're not within heckling.
Oh, I like that. Let's go. You can heckle me. Just don't heckle Tessa. Wow. Welcome. Boo. Wait, we're already booing? I did. So welcome. Welcome to the first ever That Conference Texas. Welcome. Yeah. Hopefully, I know there's some folks in the hallways and out eating. Bring your stuff in. There you go. Come on. So, first ever That Conference Texas. I am super pumped and scared shitless to be standing up here. And I have spoke to thousands of people over the last decade plus and hosted, I don't know, tens, twenties of events. So what's about to happen here will never, ever happen again. I don't mean that we're not coming back. I mean that there is never another first That Conference Texas. And the responsibility that I'm about to impart on you is something that I take pretty seriously. And that is, you all set the tone for what's about to happen for the next decade. Not me. You, this is for you. This is your event. It's a small event. It's our first event. I've done 10 others in Wisconsin. None of those matter. That's Wisconsin. This is Texas. We didn't bring our Wisconsin stuff. This is Texas. So, a little bit about me. First, my name is Clark Sell. I'm a software engineer. I own a software company called Unspecified. Yes, it's a real company. Most people think it's just what we use for testing. We do, but it's still a real company. Everybody in a red shirt is somebody who has volunteered, is also a software engineer or in software in some way. There is no corporate motive. The goal is simple. Grow the community. That's it. Make a better software development community. And for me, I feel like right now, we're in this intersection in life where we need to find our tribe more than ever in the past. The last couple years have been hell. We've been locked up. We've been at home. It's been a reboot. And that's fine. Now it's time to find our tribe again. And that tribe doesn't necessarily mean the people who are in this room. It could be a cross-section. It could be with church. It could be with family. It can be reconnecting with people in schools. It's that I believe it's super important that we start to reconnect because we are human. And humans don't work well behind Zoom. Even though we'd like to say we do, it's bullshit. Yeah, you can clap for that. I decided not to do slides today, so I engraved my notes on a seat. A lot of people have asked me, why would we come to Texas? I have family. My grandfather actually grew up in Dallas. I think there's something special about the South. I think there's something special about the upper Midwest. I think there's a lot of cool stuff going on down here. We actually put these plans in motion since about 2016. So this has been in the works for a long time. Then, of course, COVID hit. We had a delay. Then more COVID hit, so we delayed again. But we're here, finally. And it feels good to start and get the train out of the gate so that we can continue to do this. The next one will be in January, so when we're leaving this, I'm going to ask all of you for your help to help get the word out to others. Call for speakers opens, immediately closing this, right? It's time to find the tribe. It's time to find the speakers that are here. I'm immensely grateful that all of you are here, but I do have some big asks of you in how to take advantage of what this is or that is. So, we have a little experiment going on, and that experiment is, typically in Wisconsin, we have over 1,000 folks. So you have logistical concerns, right? How do you move through the halls and walls? We don't have that logistical concern in here. What happened last year in that conference was there was a lot less people and the interaction was fantastic. I got to meet people and have conversations with that I didn't get to do in previous years because there's so many people to try to get through. I am so excited for a smaller group of folks because I want to meet you all and have an in-depth conversation with you. And that's no bullshit. These rooms are designed a certain way. It's an experiment. I want your feedback. We took the conference center and we've just essentially flipped it inside out. We took away the microphone so that people would sit closer, so that it's more intimate, so that you ask more questions. We want you to be able to bounce between things easier so that you're not walking around the halls and kind of, I wouldn't say getting lost. It's not like this place is that big unless you go way over there. So it's intentional. It's an experiment. It's an experiment because the things that I've seen online, and as we've been doing that.us, is big groups of people, the conversation tends to change. It's not as intimate. People kind of go inward. You get a few people that don't leave enough acoustic space for others to join in. But when you have a 10 to 20 person conversation, a lot of people lean in and there's acoustic space to have a very dynamic conversation. So I'm super excited I'm scared shitless if I'm being honest, to see how that works and if that's something that we can somehow incorporate in future years to come. Over lunch, before I get there, we have this internal struggle of community versus an event. A lot of people think of this as an event. It's a conference. It has a start and end date. It'll be done on Thursday. I'm going to go back to my job. I'm going to go do a thing. For the people in red, and those who have been, some of you have been at that before, this for us is a community. How do we build a tribe of folks who work together 365 days out of the year? The collective knowledge in this room and in the thousands of folks that are part of that is amazing. If you want to find somebody who does a thing, somebody in this audience knows this, right? Or could point you to the real world stuff. And I think that's amazing. It's a weird business model to be able to say, hey, I want to make a community. You can't, it's hard to sell that. How to make an event? I just want to take you out of that and realize that you all are investing in yourself here to be with one another, and there's a whole bunch of intentionality in this room. The folks that are speaking, who's speaking? Rock on. Let's give these boys and girls a round of applause. Like, thank you. When you walk into one of these campsites, you have two things in common. One, everybody's interested in a topic, or they're interested in a person. The person sitting next to you, you already have something in common with. But here's the secret sauce. If what's in that room or said in that room does not spill out into this room, you have wasted your time. If it's something that you don't want or you don't like, move to another one. It's your time. It's for you to, nobody should be offended, right? Want to wear a mask? Wear a mask. Want to leave and go to another one? Leave and go to another one. It's your time. Make the best of it. Over lunch, we're going to do something called open spaces. It's going to be in this room. There's some big boards in the back. We'll kick it off and explain more. That's the second part of the secret sauce. Every time we plan an event, we do an open call for speakers, and then we try to guess. We do voting, and we try to guess what people would want to hear. But the reality is, that's not relevant to everybody. Open spaces for us is the other half of the sessions. Can we create a place where you can go and say, I need help with X, or I would like to know about this, or I would like to share my story about that? And so you have a session, and it could be 2 people, 200 people, 2 minutes, 2 hours. It's for you to decide what's important for those things. That there is the entire inspiration for why we rebuilt thatconference.com and that.us, so that we could take that secret sauce, spread it globally, and connect you from Thursday to next Sunday a year later. Back to the community piece. We need it both in person and we need it online. We need it hyperlocal and we need it global. Black, white, girl, boy, whatever, here, far, all of the experiences across the world have to come together in some way. It's physically impossible for everybody to be here. Online's an important part of that. It's an important part of this. This, that, this. Really got to get this.com. So I say that with like true compassion and energy and excitement because I feel like this, to the open spaces, to the hallways, to the sponsors, all of that is the experience, but all of that's on you. You have to make it what it is. You determine the next 10 years. With that, where are our sponsors? I see. You can raise them loud and proud. Let's give these folks, some in the back, a humongous, like, thank you. Progress, Improving, Oracle, Auth0, Simpler, Unspecified, I'm missing a few. Without them, none of this exists. Okay, I have myself, Hillary in the back, Brett, my business partner, Carrie. That's the company. I have a day job. Where's my folks in red? They're probably all outside. Brandon and John and a handful of others, right? We're all here to do this. So, but without the sponsors, we can't get the tickets to what they need to be. We can't get shipping containers moved around and all that stuff. So thank you to all of those folks for entrusting us on this first year, especially. They're just as invested in you becoming the community and setting the stage as they are for their own business needs. So stop by and talk to them. I had some fantastic conversations with the guys from Simpler, Improving, and we haven't even started yet. So please stop by, talk to them, learn about, it's not just, I think one of the best parts about tech overall is it's so small, even though we'd like to think it's big and mature and blah-de-blah, it's not. It's like 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon. You can have a conversation with a sponsor or anybody and realize that the piece of value you have for them isn't necessarily your own being, but the fact that you could connect them to somebody. That's an amazing thing. This industry is not big. Don't be a fool. We're like 6 degrees from Elon Musk. Like he's down the street apparently making cars in a Segway or some shit. I don't know. Somebody here knows him. I know somebody invited him to their cookout this weekend. So that's somebody's around here somewhere. Here you are. He's like, Elon, why don't you stop over and bring a salad? So it's huge for me. I'm grateful for all of you to be here and do this. The next 3 days are going to be amazing. Today at lunch, so we're going to serve all food out in that corridor, so it keeps quiet. Bring it back in, you know, or eat out there. Bring it back in. Lunch. Half of the lunch today, or the last half of lunch today, will be we're going to kick off open spaces. So make sure you're here for that. You can learn about what it is. We can start to get the boards going and the conversations going around that. Then we're all going to spend a moment and in deep breath, we're going to pray to the Texas gods over on the Round Rock shelf that the weather holds out so that we can have our happy hour outside in the market area. So I don't know how we do that in Texas, if there's a rain dance that we need to do, but that shit needs to not hit us. We'll do it in the market. Where's Manny? Is Manny in here? Manny right there is going to turn the turntables on. He's also keynoting on Wednesday. We're either going to do it out there or we'll do it in here. Next, we need to pray to the Delta gods, because for those of you who flew on Delta, you realize that there's a better airline, which doesn't really mean much. Because the guy who's bringing all the games for game night, his flight's been delayed and canceled and delayed, and he should be arriving on time. So game night will be in here. We've got a few duffel bags worth of games. If you have your own game, you want to play it. There'll be a bar set up, cocktails, juice, wine, and good times. And Manny turning the tables. Tomorrow, right, a little bit of the same. We're going to have a barbecue over in one epic barn, because who doesn't have a barn around here? So we're going to have a barbecue in the barn. And then we have one water park rented to ourselves, which means there is no wait. You can do a lot of repetitions on that flow rider. So, couple actions for you. Make sure your shared profile is up to date. I guess I'll talk about it. So you all got a PIN number. You were told a little bit about how we do contact transfer. Your shared profile in your... He didn't get one. he's a child. That's for you to decide, Dad. I'm not taking responsibility for that. There's a shared profile. The profile there, we are trying to be as transparent as possible about the actions that are there. You are in control of that. If you give the sponsor your PIN number, your shared profile gets transferred bidirectionally. It's just a way to do contact exchange easier. So go update that. We're rolling around with some ideas of how you can do it directly to just anybody. So future features. If you find issues, all of the source and everything that we've done and has been built is on GitHub. Log an issue, come talk to me, tell me how we can make it better. I don't care what it is. Anything here, we can make it better, do something fun. You have a crazy idea, I'm here. Like, find me. Let's have that conversation, let's have fun. If you're not in Slack and you want to be in Slack, again, that's in your profile. You can hit the join button. Magic happens, or APIs blow up, one of the two. And I would encourage you to use that.us during or after, right? We've spent rather than waiting during the pandemic for the things to change, we hit delete and built a whole new platform to service the globe. We have been busting our ass for 7 days a week for the past 2 years to get to this point. So I hope that it's something that can grow in the future. Okay, one last special shout out. So Hillary, stand up. Where's Brett? God damn it. Of course he's not. Anyways, shout out to Hillary, a shout out to Brett, and online, a shout out to Carrie. These are the folks, day in and day out, who deal with my crazy ass, the rough ride through the pandemic, the insanity that it took to get down. There's Brett. There he goes. Look at him jumping. But let's just round of applause. Like, my deepest, like, thank you for sticking with this and all of me. So now, my notes are done. Remember when I said the community is small and it kind of meanders and we meet people in certain courses of action, and you don't kind of really know where it's going to go? Well, that's the theme of today's keynote. I met Tessa, who's going to come up on stage. She spoke in Wisconsin. She's now a Texas native. It was Minneapolis or Minnesota. Used to live, which everybody wants to go south. It's warmer. Met her. We then had a conversation one day, and it was like, you and I, we're here. Like, we, like, have the same moral compass, the same, like, narcissistic drive to, like, make the world better. And we hit it off. And then the question was, listen, I need to get you on stage. You need to tell your story. And the story is, how do things like this change your world, alter your trajectory, right? Help you find your tribe? The theme of this whole week is meant to be inspirational and to take you down a certain kind of path. So Tessa's going to talk about her journey, and then Glenn's going to talk about how to have a kind of a healthy workplace environment that can be measurable so that people are happier and more productive and make better product, because your product sucks when you're not super happy. And then Manny's going to talk about how tech and hip-hop has changed like the landscape there, and just kind of pull away from, I'm assuming, outside of listening to hip-hop, there's not many people who are in that space in this room. Turns out the world's really big. Let's explore other places. So I'm excited for that. This is meant to recenter you. Every day up on stage is meant to recenter you, to bring you back, let you find your inspiration, make you think out of the box, have an open mind. And with that, let's bring Tessa on stage, and I will walk off.
All right. Well, these lights are bright. Thank you, Clark, for that lovely introduction. He is right. We both aggressively want to make the world a better place. He also mentioned that I am originally from the Midwest, which I thought was really fun. When Clark and I started talking about this keynote and what I could present and what I could share with all of you, I was excited about the fact that I'm like, yes, I've been to that conference in Wisconsin. I was local. We drove there. My whole family came. I'm a mother, obviously another expected mother. Thank you. And so it was just such a great event, and by far, honestly, one of the best events I've ever been to. And we'll get into this story in a bit here, but I've actually been to a lot of events, and I've really been very lucky in that capacity to be able to spend a lot of time with a lot of really awesome people. And so being able to be in Wisconsin and speak there, and then be able to come and speak at the first ever That Conference Texas was very exciting for me, because now I live here. And he's right, it is nice to come to the warmer weather. But I will say that, you know, the Midwest has kind of this this Minnesota nice, kind of Midwest nice. Is anyone from the Midwest? Oh, a lot of you. Awesome. Okay. So you know what I'm talking about, right? Like the I'm sorry, the very kind gestures. Southern hospitality like just blows that out of the water. So I'm just so blessed and happy that we are all here in Texas and able to experience some of that. So today I'm going to be, my talk is called Invest in Yourself by Investing in Others. And it's actually going to be more of a story. I only really have a few slides. But the first thing I wanted to share is that there is a URL and a hashtag at the bottom of this slide. So if you go to slido.com, and then you put in that event code, there's just a few interactive pieces to my talk that you'll be able to engage with. And so there should be a question there for you asking if you've been to that conference before. So I would love to know. Let me get my phone out. Yes, it should be in there. Give you all a few minutes to go in there. We can also do like a raise of hands. So how many of you have actually been to Wisconsin once you're kind of in there? Oh, like lots of you. That's amazing. Awesome. How many of you have attended some of the online events but haven't been to Wisconsin? Not as many. Good. A couple. So for a lot of you, this could be your very first That event. Is that the case for some of you? Awesome. That's amazing. Well, I'm telling you again, this is one of my absolute favorite events, so take advantage of every aspect of it. Clark and the team really curate an amazing event, and it's just really awesome to see it all take place, especially, like I said, the family side of it really gets me pretty excited. All right, so everyone should be in Slido now. There'll be a few more questions as I move forward. So my name is Tessa Kriesel. I am head of platform developer relations at Snap. That's actually a new role for me, so I've just been there for a few months, and that's going to eventually come into my story. I am a DevRel and startup advisor. I am a web developer, software engineer by trade originally, and then moved into, like Clark, I love to build communities. I love to bring people together, and so developer relations became a very natural path for my career. I am obsessed with dogs. Lover is probably like an understatement. I also shoot archery, and if you want to find me online, I am TessaK22 on Twitter, LinkedIn, on that, pretty much all over the internet. So the very first thing that I did, so I'll take it back to like younger Tessa, right? I have no college degree, not a single one. I started going to school a number of times. I tried. It is just not how I learn. I'm a hands-on learner. I need to actually like do a thing before I understand conceptually how it works and how I can leverage that in the future. You can probably figure out that's how I got into tech, right? I was actually in restaurant management. So I was working some super late hours, sometimes 1 a.m., just really like got home pretty late. And I was actually due with my first child at that point in time. I'm from a small town, so you get married, you have kids, that's like what you do, right? So I'm getting home late and I'm thinking about the fact that like I'm gonna have a baby. Like I don't wanna have these hours when I'm gonna have a baby at home. I'm gonna have a family I'm gonna wanna spend time with. I wanna have dinner with them. I want us to sit at the dinner table. And I started just dabbling in HTML and CSS. Just, you know, front-end dev stuff. I think this was back in like 2006. So long before Code Academy was a thing, long before any of these other really great tutorials and online courses were in existence. There was some stuff, right? But it was paper books. And so I started looking at templates. I started looking at websites and source code, just really trying to like break it all down and figure out exactly how I could figure out how to code. And so, you know, kind of dug into a little bit of that front end stuff and decided that I had a project that I wanted to build. So kind of going back to Slido, I think this is my next question. Nope, I took it out. Have any of you played Guitar Hero before? Yes, so many of you. I wish we could play Guitar Hero here. That would be amazing. Anyways, so coming around to Guitar Hero, I was obsessed with Guitar Hero. So when I was pregnant, I stopped working towards the end, obviously, and I had a baby at home. And I was like obsessed with Guitar Hero. So I decided that if I was going to get better at Guitar Hero, I had to start playing people that were better than me. My husband was like, that was out. I was beating him. He wasn't catching up. So it's like, who else am I going to play Guitar Hero with? So I wanted to build a tournament community. And so I started thinking about what would it take for me to build a tournament site? Like, how do I bring people in? How do I play against different people? Like, sure, at that time, you could go play online and find some random person that they'd anonymously match you with. But I wanted, like, a hierarchy, right? I wanted to be able to improve and compete with people that I somewhat knew. So I decided to build a Guitar Hero tournament community. All I had was, like, HTML and very, like, basic CSS skills. And so I needed folks to be able to authenticate. I needed folks to be able to enter in their scores that needed to validate with the other person that they were playing. And so there's a lot I had to learn. Most of you are engineers, or at least an extension, I assume. So you all know where I'm going, right? I needed a lot more tech skills to be able to build this thing. So I started pulling together and looking at a few different PHP content management systems. I think there was actually even a couple that were not PHP-based, but I didn't know what I was doing. I was just pulling things together, right? And so I ended up landing on Joomla. Has anyone heard of Joomla? Yeah. Demo, are you in here? Yes. So Demo and I actually met in the Joomla community, and now we were in the WordPress community together. Demo still is. I have moved on from WordPress, but it's been really fun to like see that progression. So long story short, I started digging into Joomla. There was a PHP developer who also loved Guitar Hero, much like me, and he is the one that I am referencing in this slide. I tried like crazy to look through my emails and see if I could find his name so I could mention him in this talk, but I couldn't find them because, you know, emails and it's been years later, right? So he knows who he is, he knows what he did to change my life, but he is the one person that really put me on a career trajectory towards software engineering and web development. One person changed my life. And this story is really all about how I continued to want to change other people's lives. So anyways, he helps me, we figure it out, right? We build this tournament hierarchy, we've got a community. We start out pretty small, but then people really start coming in. They start volunteering. They start, you know, helping us build out tournaments. Before you know it, we're at like 5,000 members, 5,000-person community. We're all jamming out to Guitar Hero. And Activision hits me up. And they're like, hey, we would really love for you to be a moderator in our forum. And I was like, okay, that's super cool, right? Like, I'm a small-town girl in the middle of central Minnesota, and Activision is talking to me. Very, very cool. Then it gets better. So they also start reaching out and tell me that they want to host all of our tournaments on the Activision community website. I was like, mind blown, right? So we end up getting our tournaments on the website. Our community just keeps growing. And it just ends up being this like amazing experience for the absolute first big project that I ever built. And one PHP developer helped me make that happen. So eventually I pass on it. The PHP developer that helped me, I pass the project on to him. I was a mom now. I didn't get to play Guitar Hero as much, which was a bit of a sad day, but that does happen. But I think it's just, it's really incredible when I think about everything that I got to do and that one person really like drove that forward. So it doesn't end there, right? There's a lot more exciting things that happen. So Joomla was just kind of the beginning. So at that point in time, I started freelancing. Actually, has anyone like used Craigslist when it was like still good? Yes, like you know, like 2007, 2008, 2009 range. I got so much work off of Craigslist. Like it was actually crazy how much I actually got off of there. So I met a few different people that kept getting web projects in. And so I started building websites for those people. And so my Joomla skills got better and better and better. And I continued to work on websites with a number of different people that I just met on the internet. That kind of progresses. I finally get my first role at a product company, which was really, really exciting. I think that happened about 2011-ish. And so I'm out of my element, right? I'm with a bunch of other people that I'm working with. I've been working alone and trying to kind of code at least the best way I know how, all on my own, right? And so I join a team. And there's really something pretty great about a team. How many of you are freelancers? Okay, only a handful of you. Do you have folks that you work with, like, closely? Yeah. It's really isolating to be by yourself. I feel like we all kind of know that after the last couple years, right? It's really lonely to actually work by yourself. And so I got to spend time with a lot of folks that were on a team and had mentors around me, right, that started to improve my technical skills. In that role, I actually got to work in over 100 different CMSs. I mean, you name it, I probably touched it at some point in time. And it wasn't like a big deal, right? I had to go in and create a few pages, create an integration, get it connected to our product, and then off they went. So it was for chambers of commerce. So it was just a variety of different like chambers and what their websites were in. It was a really great role, and it really helped me start to evolve and see what it would be like to actually work in a company, right? So I was inside of a company. After that role, I actually got recruited to a different company because they were specifically looking for a Joomla person. So again, kind of coming back to this like one developer, right? They gave me the tangible skills to like learn enough about Joomla for someone to actually go and recruit me. Like this is the first time that that ever happened. And I was like, okay, this is cool. Someone's coming after me. Like this could be a really great career, right? Where can we go with this? So I took that role. It was a really great role, managed all of their web properties for their entire company. And they had, I want to say 30 to 40 different brands. So it was a number of websites that I was managing. Really great opportunity. Again, taught me a lot, but I was kind of like a one-person team. And I realized like a one-person team is like not all that rewarding. It's rewarding in terms of like, whoa, look at all these websites that I manage, right? People are happy, bosses are happy, but I'm a little lonely still. I like having those people to like push me to be a better developer, a better engineer, and learn more. So we moved to the Minneapolis area. We left our tiny little small town. And we moved to the Minneapolis area. How many of you have been to Minneapolis? Oh, lots of you. I love, love, love Minneapolis. Lots of amazing things to see there. So we moved to the Minneapolis area. We were in a suburb. And I figured out this thing called meetup.com. I feel like we all of us probably know what meetup is now today, right? I didn't. This was new for me. They don't have those in small towns. Nobody gets together when your town is 300 people. Maybe all of us could get together and have one conference, town conference. Anyways, so I figured out that there was this organization called Girl Develop It. Has anyone heard of Girl Develop It? Yes. Yes. Great organization. So they were having some classes and they needed a TA. And it was HTML and CSS, like just kind of 101, really basic. And I was like, I can handle that. I can help with that. So I go into the class and I TA and it's like I'm in my element. And I had no idea that like this was my element, that I wanted to like teach someone else, right? This one PHP developer made me feel so empowered by him teaching me and mentoring me that I was like, I have to pass this down, right? And on top of it, it was a lot of work to figure out how to code back then. And so I'm like, if I can make it easier for someone else, let's do this, right? TA'd the first class, and the chapter leaders came up to me and they're like, hey, you were like amazing. Do you think you could teach the next class? And I was like, well, I mean, do you have curriculum for that? Like, what does that look like? And they're like, no, we don't. No one's taught that class. We just think that, you know, there are folks that would want it and they'd want to advance. So I thought about it for a bit and I was like, you know what? Yeah, like I'm so empowered right now. I'm so happy after teeing this class. Like, I feel like this would be amazing. So I said yes pretty quickly, then realized it's a lot of work to pull together curriculum. Has anyone had to pull together curriculum before? Yeah, it's way more work than you expect it to be. But I loved it, right? Like, I'm getting to teach folks things that I knew. So I pulled together the curriculum, and I teach the HTML and CSS, like, 201 class. So we kind of start diving into, like, responsiveness a little bit, making sure that they're really thinking about how they're building that code instead of just putting, you know, HTML on a page, because really what they learned was very basic. Loved it. The class loved it. I met so many amazing women that I was like, what's next? Like, what do we do next? They're like, well, we can keep offering this class. And I was like, yeah, but they need to know the next steps. Like, how do they get their site on the internet? How do we take them further? How do they learn about Git? What about JavaScript? What about these other things, right? And so I started to build additional curriculum. We took them to a third level of HTML and CSS. I taught a Git class. I taught a WordPress class. We talked about, it's kind of like a best practices sort of a class where it was like, here's how you kind of get your stuff on the internet. Here's why you do it this way. Here's what servers are. Here's how you get things to the servers. And I actually had women who went through all of those different classes. And over all of the classes, I've taught over 300 women to code. Yeah, that's what I think. Like, I think that too. Woo! As someone who is, like, non-educated herself, right? I didn't know what I was doing. I felt like, in the beginning, I was like, can I do this? And then realize that I'm actually empowering women to make career changes. So throughout all of that, that was very exciting. But I think the bigger part of it for me was the people that I met, right? And so, yeah, I spent a lot of time writing curriculum, actually teaching the class, showing up on my weekends, you know, spending time away from my family, right, to do this. But at the end of the day, I met so many amazing people that actually, like paved the way for the rest of my story. And at that time, I had no idea that they were actually going to be the cement that was on that sidewalk that I was going to be on. So my next role ended up, so when I moved to Minneapolis, I was at an agency doing a lot of WordPress work. Loved it. I love agency work. I'm like the kind of person that wants to talk to the client. How many of you like to talk to clients? Okay, so like not tons of you, right? There are not many of us who actually like to talk to clients. For the most part, it's kind of nice to just stay back and do your work. But I love people, if that isn't obvious enough at this point. And so I loved talking to clients. I was ready for a transition and ready for kind of a change. I had was just having my third child at that time. And so went out on maternity leave and decided that like when I came back, I was going to try something different. One of the teachers through Girl Develop that I met, she taught the basic 101 class, actually worked at General Mills. And so she introduced me to her hiring manager of a team that was serving the open source space. And I got a job there. This was like huge, right? General Mills is big. Who knows about General Mills? I feel like everybody. Have you eaten Cheerios before? Like, you know, like it's a big deal, right? And so she led me into that path, and it was just something that could have never happened if it wouldn't have been for the time and the energy and the volunteering that I put into the Girl Development organization. When I was kind of ready for a transition after that, it was about 2017, end of 2017, and I was looking at this role, and it was called an agency and community engineer. Has anyone heard of a title similar to that? No, me neither. I was like, what is this? What is like an agency and community engineer? And like, community, I can get behind this, right? As you've probably already tell through my kind of story, communities are big for me. Like, I love bringing people together. So I applied for this role. I didn't know the company. I didn't know any of the people, which was weird for me because when I was working with Girl Develop It, I mean, I met people at Best Buy, Target, General Mills, Caribou Coffee. Anyone been to Caribou Coffee? Okay. I miss Caribou Coffee, like a lot actually. When I go back to Minnesota, though, I will be visiting Caribou Coffee a lot. And actually, one of the folks that I met through the connection at Best Buy gave me a project at Caribou Coffee. So in 2019, I actually rebuilt CaribouCoffee.com, which I was very excited about because I'm a big Caribou fan, if you can't tell. And so again, kind of like leading into this, like all these connections came from these women that I taught because we had sponsors, we had people we hosted events at, things like that. So long story short, let's get back to this role that I applied to. So I applied to this role, and I was really excited about it because it had a lot of teaching in it, it had a lot of training in it, it had a lot of community building, I got to spend time with people, I got to go out to events like this one. And so I applied for that job, and I ended up talking to some of the Girl Develop It women about it on the organizing team. And one of them was like, oh, I know that company. And she's like, do you know who the hiring manager is? And I was like, I don't. I just applied. And so she started digging, and she's like, I know the hiring manager. And I'm like, okay, this is cool. So figure out she knows the hiring manager. Her significant other, who's an engineer, he also knows the hiring manager. And both of them go to him, and they're like, you should really hire Tessa. And I was like, whoa, okay. Again, another connection that I just never thought would happen. Got the job. That was my first job in DevRel. I had no idea what an agency and community engineer was. They didn't know what DevRel was, right? It wasn't kind of an industry known. Does anyone else know what DevRel is? Okay, I'm going to touch on that before I end so everyone has kind of a general idea. But essentially, this role was very similar to a developer advocate. So I did a lot of coding, I did a lot of trainings, I did a lot of presentations like this, did a lot of blog post writing, I'd pull together code samples for other developers to be able to leverage. It was pretty much my dream job. Like, I had landed my dream job. I spent a number of years at that company, really loved what I was doing, really loved, the people that I got to present in front of. And so this is where, like, I feel like my numbers get into the thousands. And I probably didn't change these people's lives in terms of like these thousands of people that came to my workshops and my talks and read my content, but I do feel like I helped them in some way. I do truly feel like the 300 women that I taught that I changed their lives in some way, shape, or form. So we're up to like 1,300 people probably at this point, by at least that I'm counting, that I've been able to impact in some way through some of these opportunities that either I've been given or someone else helped me get. So I'm starting to advance my career beyond this first DevRel role, and I started looking out into the job market for different opportunities. I wanted to do something in community, and I put it out there just a tiny bit, and I actually had, I think I had 6 offers I had to compare after I decided to leave that role. And I kind of sat back and I was like, how is an uneducated small town girl have 6 offers at many of which were big tech companies? And it really like had me reflecting like everything that I've done to get here, right? So I ended up taking a job at Twitter. Anyone familiar with Twitter? And I led developer community at Twitter. Twitter! How in the world did I get to Twitter? Like, it just blew my mind that this is where I was spending my time. Has anyone worked with the Twitter API? Yes. Okay, so some of you know that Twitter did a great job of serving developers. Then they took a bunch of stuff back. Then I had to lead the community after they did that. It was a very, very interesting job, but I got to meet so many unique people because when you're working in communities, the thing that you're doing is being there for those people, right? Finding your tribe, like Clark said. You're bringing those people together that want to hang out with one another. And so at Twitter, those folks weren't too happy to be spending time with the tribe because Twitter had taken away a lot of amazing opportunities that they had to build some really great apps. So I had to rebuild trust with those folks. And you might think that that would be a very challenging job, and it was a challenging job, but it was actually the most rewarding job I've ever had. Has anyone had to like have a job where they came in and they felt like they were like in the negative, right? If we're talking checkbooks, you're like in the negative and you're like, how do I even get to a place of zero and before I can even get a positive balance? Anyone been in that place? Yeah, it's kind of hard, right? It doesn't matter like what capacity it is. It makes the job a lot harder, but it also makes the job a lot more rewarding. So as you can imagine, I met a number of really amazing people when I worked at Twitter as well. And so when I was actually at Twitter, I was really diving into building trust with developers, which I don't know if anyone knows, it is not an easy job to build trust with developers. They really like don't want to like hang out with you unless you're one of them or you understand them. And so I had to get really creative, right? I had to get really creative about how I built programs, about how I started to rebuild trust with them, how I figured out how they didn't hate the Twitter API anymore. And through all of that, I started writing a bunch of content. And so as I'm writing this content, I'm essentially like instilling the things that I was learning throughout my job, right? What is it that I'm doing to build their trust? How am I doing this? How am I leveraging all of that, right? So I started a blog. I started a DevRel blog. So if you want to visit it, it's devocate.com, which is like D-E-V-O-C-A-T-E. I link it later. And so I started this blog, and essentially it's all from content of like me working at Twitter and some of my previous roles and things that I had learned in my career. I had no idea where this blog was going to go. No idea. I just knew that I had a passion for sharing some of these things because I'm like, whoa, this isn't an easy job. That blog has now, I think probably, I'm trying to think if we've got some like actual stats here. It sees about 2,000, well, I have it in the slide, but it has about 2,000 unique visitors that visit that blog like each and every month. And so that's just unique visitors, right? There's also routine visitors. I don't know the actual numbers, but there have been like a lot of folks who have come and said, hey, you know what? Your blog actually got me into DevRel, or your blog actually changed my trajectory for my career, or your blog actually gave me insightful information to be able to move forward in my role. If you can't tell, I'm kind of like paving a path here, right? A path of like, if you give back to other people, that comes back tenfold. I mean, would you ever think that an uneducated small town girl would get a job at Twitter? My peers surely didn't in my small town. They're all still shocked by the fact that I worked at Twitter. And like, now I'm at Snap, right? And even also a big company. And so I think, you know, as Clark and I really talked about this, the thing that really stuck with us is that we have both given back a lot in different ways, right? All in different types of capacities, in different, you know, entities. When I was in Minneapolis, I also got really involved with the coding boot camp. Has anyone heard of Prime Academy? I feel like if you're Midwest, no? Yes, awesome. It's a kind of niche code school that's in Minneapolis. They do a really great job, and I have actually mentored some folks through there too. And I think that, you know, a lot of us have mentored other people, right? Whether it be our coworkers, our peers, whether we go out of the way to write content, whether we go out of the way to share our GitHub repositories or share how we built something. And the thing about all of that is that we have no idea what that impact is going to look like until we can take like a full view on our career path or on how those people have affected us. And I can tell you right now, hundreds of people have now helped me in return, right? You kind of heard just some of those people that helped me get to like some of those different roles and some of the capacities and places that they've played a part. And so I think for me, like what I really want to instill, you know, with all of you, let me look at my slide real quick. I think I have a really great question on here. Oh, one second. The bummer about this is I can't present this with my slides. I just put another question on there. The thing that I really want to share with all of you is that there have been people who have literally changed my life, I mean financially, in a career standpoint, that I've grown as a human, I've grown as a mom, I've grown in so many different ways because of people who have been there and offered to like help me in all of these different places, who have given me opportunities. And I think that, oh, my phone went to sleep, one second. And I think that there's likely a chance that all of you have done the same thing, right? So when we give back, we don't know what that's actually going to allude to. We don't know what the end results are going to be. But when we're able to do that, the end results can be monumental. Like I said, hundreds of people have helped me in return. And I feel like I've helped probably thousands of people at this point. I maybe didn't completely change their life, but I've done something that has altered it or something that has altered the path that they're on. So The Snap story is actually pretty exciting for me. So the blog that I was talking about, is a lot of really strong DevRel content, essentially, that was just me just passion writing, right? It was just, hey, here's what I know. I'm just getting it on paper. To be totally honest with you, some of the times I was very frustrated because I'm like, this is what I want to do, but I can't quite do it because limitations, corporate policies, things like that, right? And some of the things were things I got to do. And so through that blog, I actually ended up getting a lot of like recognition in the DevRel space. I've been in DevRel since late 2017, not super long time, right? I ended up like getting put on a list of like top influencers in DevRel. Completely surprised to see that happen. And then with my blog, I actually had the hiring manager from Snap reach out to me directly. And so early in this year, I decided I was going to go completely freelance. I was going to do DevRel consulting, help different companies get their DevRel programs started up, and really just kind of be my own boss. The Snap hiring manager reached out to me, and I kind of laughed a little because I was like, I am way too old to work at Snapchat, like way too old. I'm really glad the rest of you are laughing because I really thought that. And he reached out at the end of last year, and I just kind of like brushed it off. Like, that's not something that I'm going to have an interest in. And then he reached out again. He was like, hey, like, I'd really, really love to talk to you. And I was like, okay, I will talk to you. But only because at this point, I've grown my DevRel community and space pretty wide. And so I'm like, maybe I can help you find someone. So we get on the phone and we start talking. And I figure out that Snap doesn't share user data. Did any of you know that? They share no user data with anybody. It doesn't matter how much you pay them. They share no data. And for me, I was like, okay, I'm listening. What else you got? And we started talking about what the role would look like and what products they were serving and the things that they were doing. And if you haven't figured this out by now, I love helping people. I really love helping people, especially when they're early in their career. Because for me, it was very hard early on to get through some of those steps. Sure, I found some really good cheats. Organizing Girl Develop It and teaching a lot of people was a good cheat. Mentoring a lot of people was also a good cheat. I don't really say it's a cheat, right? I'd put a lot of work into it. But at the end of the day, it really led me to like the end of the game, right? The best part of the game. If you're playing Monopoly, it's like, you know, you get to go and then collect $200 again. That's what I feel like some of these things that I've done are like little cheats. And so anyways, we keep talking and he's like, yeah, you know, it's obviously our audience is a lot of like Gen Z. That's most of our user adoption. You know, those are the folks that we feel are going to be most excited about working with our products. He starts breaking the products down to me, and I start realizing, like, all right, they don't share user data. It's going to be people who are earlier in their career, not always, right, but going to be earlier in their career. They really deeply care. Their cultures are kindness, creativity, and being smart. It's like kind, smart, and creative. I mean, like, who can't get behind that, right? For me, I feel like that's like some of my personal values. So I'm like, okay, tell me more. So we keep talking about it. And then he starts telling me about the team. And so we start breaking down some of the functions. And at this point, I'm like, okay, this sounds cool, but I'm still not interested because I just didn't think that I would be a fit at Snapchat. Again, felt like I was a little too old for that like generational role. So I start giving him advice, and I'm like, hey, you know what? You really need a community. If you had a community, folks would be able to come in and like self-serve and be able to ask questions and work with each other. And he's like, oh, that's cool. So he starts asking me more questions. I had no clue that that was my interview with the hiring manager. No clue. It turns out if you give really good advice in interviews, it actually works out really, really well for you. So anyways, I actually pass along a few folks for the role. And I tell them that, hey, there's a few candidates I know that would be really great. Pass them along. He comes back again. And he's like, are you sure you don't want to talk? Like, you just like maybe one more person. And eventually I'm like, okay, fine. I'll give in. Like, I'll talk to the rest of the folks. Let's just see what the rest of this interview process looks like. I end up meeting people, and they're like the kindest people. Has anyone been at a company where the culture is actually really, truly the culture that they say? Yes. Doesn't it feel good? So good. The people I'm meeting are kind. They're very smart. Is it a sponsor? Is that what we're going? Oh, who are you? Is it improving? All right, improving. We're going to call them out. Good job improving for having good culture. Hey, that's hard to find. I've been through some roles. It is hard to find. And they are, they're all exuding kindness and creativity, and they're smart. And again, more than anything, they're kind. And my A, number one MO is kindness. Like, I will always lead with kindness. I want everyone to feel kindness. Minnesota to Texas, right? Southern hospitality, Minnesota nice. It's just, it's in my blood. And so I keep going through the interviews, right? And I'm like, okay, I don't know. I'm getting excited about the role. But I feel a little bad because the other person that I sent for a candidate is actually one of my dear friends. And so I'm sitting here trying to have, like, you know, I had these mixed feelings of I want this role, but I also really want this other person to get the role. And so we keep talking about it. And I, obviously, you know kind of the end story here, right? I get to the point where I'm like, yeah, I really want this role. Like, I can keep helping my friend get another role. Like, we'll see what happens, right? I get the offer, an offer I never, ever would have expected. Like, just never, ever would have expected. This is like the point where I get slightly emotional because, like, when I think about everything that I did and I think about the fact that I don't have a college degree and I worked really, really, really hard, non-educated, my husband's a stay-at-home dad, so I've been the breadwinner for a number of years. It's just so incredibly rewarding to know that, like, I've changed so many people's lives and they've changed my life, right? Like, I got here because of all those people that impacted me. Now I'm at Snap. Like, Snap. Who would have thought an almost 40-year-old woman would be working at Snap? I didn't. But kind of coming back around, I think that, you know, this opportunity was something that I never, ever would have gotten if I would not have given back, if I would not have contributed, if I would not have built my blog, honestly. We were in one of the first meetings with my manager, and it was me, my manager, and a few other people, and he was like, hey, have you seen Tessa's blog? I had no idea that he had seen my blog. Not at all. And they were like, no. Like, where is it? So he's like, yeah, you got to go check it out. And he starts, like, just praising my blog and everything that I've written in DevRel. And I was like, ah, here's how I got the job. So it's just, it's so interesting the things that you choose to do, right? Whether it be intentional, whether it be out of passion, frustration and passion, or wherever that may take you. But for me, it's been completely life-changing. And I just, if there's anything that I want to instill here, and I'm actually slightly early on my time, but if there's anything that I really want to instill here, it's that giving back and helping other people, whether it be the person next to you, whether it be your neighbor, helping them carry something in, you just don't know the ramifications of what that's going to look like and where that's going to take you and what you're going to be able to do with that. I'm able to, like, donate money. I'm able to do so many different things that I couldn't do before. You know what else Snap has? They actually pay me to go volunteer. Like, I can go volunteer places. So on top of, like, everything else I get to do, like, I get to take some of my working time and go volunteer at other places, which, again, giving back, right? And in some way, I know that's going to come back around because it always does. So this is a few different places that you can find me. I mentioned my blog up there, which, you know what, also just happened. I just sold my blog and my business for more money than I ever could have imagined just this week. So that's actually another celebratory thing for me as well. So just really exciting. And I'm thankful to be here with all of you. I would love to chat with as many of you as possible. I think that there are so many different ways we can all change the world and that we can all do more in our spaces to bring our tribe together and to build our communities. Thank you.
Can I get your Snap code?
My Snap code? Tessa K 22 on Snap also.
How many of you use Snap?
Yes.
How many you use Snap because your kid uses Snap?
Yep, that's the same for me.
Yep. So, let's leave it.
Okay.
So that. Well, hold on. Before I get to that story, let's give Tessa another round of applause. Like, I think the story she shares, the journey. I don't think we often kind of look into the vulnerable parts of how we really get to where we are. And it's important for me because all of you are here. You took the step. I tell people all the time, like, unless you step, nobody's going to step to you. There's a lot of people who never go to a user group, join online, and I'm not saying that that needs to be your thing, but all too often people think they have nothing to share. They have zero value that they can bring to somebody else, and it's complete and utter bullshit. We all have something that we can share with somebody else and it can help them in some way. How you scale yourself to share, that's up to you, whether it's a blog or a video or a thing or a this. It's a different world, but you gotta step. All of you stepped, and I appreciate that, right? Now take the next step the next few days. Now the snap story. When I started that conference, family was always meant to be a big piece of our DNA as to why we're here. My kids, so I guess I associate as Gen M, I, Gen Z. No, that's my kid. Gen X. I don't know. Gen X. I'm older than I look, but thank you. So my kids have always grown up around tech. I have a 16 and a 14-year-old boy, girl. Always grew up around tech. When they were first born, I worked at Microsoft, so we had weird gadgets and lots of things that were part of that. They never knew an interface that you couldn't touch other than my Mac. That was supposed to be funny. Really? Shit. The one joke. That joke really worked in rehearsal. Their world and how they grew up, the lens that they look is so different than my lens. Drastically different. My kids use Snap in a way that I still don't understand, and I still don't even know how to add people. But that's their lifeblood. Not SMS or WhatsApp or whatnot. So when you step back and you just ask the question of, like, what does your world look like in tech, and then what does their world look like in tech or somebody else, you'd be amazed at just how utterly different it is. Now let's come back to that conference. My thing always was, if there was an adult in the audience of a kid presenting, we had won. We had achieved our goal. Because that meant that finally we've crossed this gap that said, hey, I recognize that you might not be a professional or whatnot, but the value you have is teaching my old ass what it's like, right? There are things that have happened here simply out of feedback from an 8-year-old because they didn't like it a certain way or didn't see it a certain way. And if I wasn't open to it, I wouldn't have realized it. I still don't understand why they use Snap all the time for chatting, but it's the thing that they do, right? Family's a big piece of that conference. There's two rooms. There's a small number of family sessions. So for those of you who brought kids, like, there are some great sessions that are being given. Take them over there. Do that. You all I would assume you all identify as some kind of software engineer or developer. We have built a marble wall and 3D printed a bunch of parts. It's meant more so for the kids, but we're all kids at heart. I challenge you. We're going to bring the wall out in the hallway. I challenge you to see if you can actually get the marble around. You can build software, but let's see if you can move a BB around the wall. Because it ain't as easy as it looks. It was easier to 3D print the parts than it is to make the thing work. So have fun with that. There are some family sessions over there. Also, your spouses and kids and whatnot, they're invited to be here at the keynotes and whatnot. So, you know, make sure that they're here. In that back corner, we have a soldering station and some little badges that you can solder. You had to sign a waiver because if you burn yourself, I'm not responsible. But there's some badges back there. Have fun making some stuff. There's a puzzle over in that corner. I challenge all of you to try to finish it by the end of the conference. There's, I don't know how many thousands of the pieces. I think it's a great symbolic, like, gesture of what we can do together as a team. As one person, it takes a really long time to put that puzzle together. Question is, can we all put it together before we leave? Again, I challenge you to meet new people, to find their stories. There'll never be another first time, right? So lean into that. Our sponsors outside, Unspecified, Improving Progress, Oracle Blues, Robert Half, Simpler, Auth0, and Zuplo. Awesome companies, all invested, all do cool shit. We use Auth0. Zuplo is this new API thing that they're working on. They're looking for a ton of feedback. Now I'm going upwards. Simpler, the two guys in the back, awesome humans, had a great conversation about the stuff that they're doing. Robert Half, the folks showed up yesterday, been a longtime supporter of us. Blues, IoT, Brandon's gonna take the stage at lunch and kick off our open spaces. Oracle just popped in, we all know who Oracle is. Progress, a few of us used to work at this little company called Telerik. They got bought by a company named Progress. They make a bunch of cool stuff as well. Improving's down here heckling. Love it. My company's Unspecified. I'm really desperate for some work. With that being said, I am flattered that you all would be up here. Give me your snap codes. Let's give Tessa another round of applause. Part of the reason we have such big breaks between sessions, it's because the sessions are important, but the networking is important too. So with that, I'm out, and I'll see you at lunch. Thank you for being here. Some people would say to accept defeat. What if this is fate, then we'll find